how much we'll have to burn before we will look to the past to learn. We walk along this endless path, which has led us in a circle, so here we are right back. We can't let the future become our past.
Safety in trees. I think the most important thing to remember when working with trees in the arboricultural industry is that we're working with a natural force. We're working with something not man-made. We're working with something that, over the years, has grown to its own specifications, to its own surroundings. It's something that sometimes gets left behind when we're starting a job. It's all good and well to put a harness on, start a chainsaw, and start cutting timber. But compression, fungus, decayed sections can all impact on your day-to-day career, because it's very important to realise and take a step back and have a good look at what we are working with. Different varieties of trees, there's so many in this world that it's hard to keep a track of them all, but they all react different ways to how we cut them, how we prune them, how we go about it.
Won't you tell me please, how many miles must we march?
Yeah, I certainly think, Dave, after my years of experience, there's a high turnover within the tree industry. It's hard physical work. It's you are expected a lot within your crew. Most important thing to realise here is there's certainly big gaps in the different levels of your crew. You've got a crew leader who is the most experienced of all your crew. I think more importantly, your new man that comes on board, it's more important to concentrate on your crew leader and how much time he's actually going to give your freshman, because you're working with noise, you're working with a lot of noise, chainsaws, mulches, chippers. If there's not an intimate sort of sense of that within your crew, then you're going to end up potentially creating a high-risk environment. They need to know that the ideal crew is one that's worked together for 6 months and starts to know how each other thinks, how each other operates.
Something they taught us to do. We can't let our future become our past if we are to change the world.
So to get a new guy on board, it's important before the noise starts, before starting machinery and the like, to definitely spend some time with him, getting him to trust you, getting you to trust him, and seeing what his perspective of what his job title is, because a lot of guys are just told to get out there and start doing hard labour, and especially in the scenario where this minimal noise, you've got earmuffs on that are trying to block that out, then he's not going to just understand or hear you when you're yelling from 50 foot high in a tree. You have to explain a few things to him to begin with, not just the machines that he's using. Ideally, if he is not very experienced in the tree game, he's not going to be using those just yet anyway. He is purely and purposefully a labourer within your crew, but it needs to be important that he learns certain signals. There's countless amounts of signals over the years that you formulate for yourself and for your crew. There's certainly a few that are universal, but more importantly, you need to gain that trust from that person initially, and let him know that if a certain signal is given out and he can't hear what you're talking about, then he needs to know to get out of that drop zone, to move a certain piece of machinery, to just be aware of what's about.
How many miles must we march? Whoa, how many miles must we march?
Time is money. Pressure comes from every direction in your life. And something from a management point of view that I've certainly had to look at from a different angle is that pure fact that you don't realise what a guy's come from his home scenario to work. Now, in a work environment, you obviously have pressure from your boss to get work done. We need to make money. That's the aim of the game. You get pressures from the client. You get pressures from your missus at home. You get pressure from different parts of your life. But the main thing to realise is that that is an important thing. We need to allow time where it's not just the pure fact that there's so much work, we just need to get it done. We need to allow ourselves in a business such as set up like Paradise Trees, where we are ahead of our work schedule. And in that being that, you know, 3 months have gone really smoothly. We're ahead of our targets. From a management perspective, that's when you certainly need to step back, allow yourself a day, as a training day, as a day of learning how, all right, throwing a scenario out there, what's going to happen if a man is 50 foot up in the tree, you're an inexperienced ground crew, and he's just cut himself with a chainsaw, he's just hit his head, he's unconscious, or a scenario where you don't know exactly what's happened up there, but you can see that something's not right. These discussions really do need to be had, I think, in the tree industry, because they're important, because otherwise people go into panic station. They don't know, well, they've never thought of it that way. It's just the day-to-day work. Some of the safest operators in the industry have come unstuck, and that's important, especially for your newcomers all the way through. I've worked with guys over the years who 20 years experience. They've never sat down in a group environment and discussed what the scenario would be should something happen on site. What's the program? What are we doing? Do we get an ambulance on site? Do we have to, hopefully you've got someone trained in aerial rescue, because an ambulance is going to rock up. They're not going to have a cherry picker to be able to go up and get your man from the tree. And in the modern day, that's incredibly important.
There must come a day when a box is not somebody's home. Won't you tell me, please?